sometimes have to use the food from there. And they come in first of the month, and they put food in, in hopes they're going to make it all the way through the month. And we have one who comes in, and when she does have to come in, she very carefully brings her broom with her. She sweeps out the food pantry, and she makes sure everything is nicely arranged on the shelves and wipes the shelves off. And so it does make a difference in our community, and people do appreciate it. Are there any other announcements?
Dear Lord.
Yes?
Okay. Next Sunday, like you said, is Men's Club. Men's Group, okay. Saturday, the Girl Scouts are having the community yard sale in the front parking lot, okay? So, and they throw it over, and it's going to be, and it's open to everybody to sell something.
That's why it's called community.
So if Tommy and Frank will do the hot dogs, Tommy's going to talk to Andy about possibly doing hot dogs out there, because we've got hot dog rolls and we got hot dogs, so we got basically everything we need.
That would be very nice.
So if anybody's interested,
you have things you have
you got things you want to buy, or if you got things you want to get rid of.
Whether it's $25 a table?
Yes, yeah. But and it's benefit of the Girl Scouts that go to our church here.
Yes.
What were the hours that the
nine to two.
Nine to two.
Thank you.
I'm sorry.
Okay. And I didn't move from the desk to the table to get that paper. I forgot about it yesterday. I thought I had another week on that. Right. I'm confused. Start the month on a Monday. I have no idea the rest of the month. If there are no other announcements, as we come forward, as we begin our opening hymn, we'll bring the light in. On your feet now! Applaud God! Bring a gift of laughter. Sing your way into His presence as we sing, "To God be the glory." Oh, shoot. applaud God.
Bring a gift of laughter, sing yourselves into his presence.
Know this, God is God, he made us, we didn't make him.
We're his people, his well and his sheep.
Enter with the password, thank you.
Make yourselves at home, talking praise.
Thank him, worship him.
For God is sheer beauty, all generous in love, loyal always and ever.
Let us worship God with joy. Please be seated. Age-wise young people, but we have young people at heart. My mother always told me that God has a good sense of humor. One of her things was to take plants and you find out how quickly. Because we know from scripture that man proposes, as my mother used to say, God disposes. You know, we get things ready. We know what we want to do, we're going to do it. This is not today. I have something better planned for you. We had planned, we didn't know when that little cute little baby was going to be born. Came along in that point of time when he'd be just getting home from the hospital. It's not too fair to leave the new baby at home with mama right off. And so Pastor Dennis is at home enjoying that new boy. And here I am. Now I planned. We had a feeling it was going to happen. So I planned. If you notice, I was up there fumbling on the first hymn. I spent, no exaggeration, it's hard to get those words on the PowerPoint, especially if you use the one that comes from Cokesbury. That and I don't even speak anymore. I spent probably an hour and a half getting all the words to the two hymns, and I was so proud, and I got them in first. I even went to the total end to see if that's where they were. They're gone. I hear you, Lord. You're laughing. But today is a day about celebrating, about seeing the joy of the Lord in everything around us, and in singing out, shouting out, in praise. I always like this Sunday with the children because I talk about the lilies. This part of the lily, the trumpet. The trumpet. That's supposed to tell us something. It's new life, yes. Because this is the time of year they bloom. And that reminds us of that. But the trumpet. Sound the trumpet. Bring the good news into the world. And the good news, the word good, doesn't that make you want to smile? Sometimes, I'll get into that in a few minutes. I got some good words on that one. I'll just whet your appetite with that one. The bottom line is, we are here to rejoice, to be filled with joy, and not like we've just had, I don't know, the most sour thing you can imagine, and we were forced fed. That's sometimes what the face is that we look from, pastors and choir directors look from where they are in a service. Yeah. I used to count the paint streaks on the ceiling. Yeah. We do that. We are to rejoice, the trumpet. We trumpet out the good news. And it's not just with our mouths, it's with our whole being. How we interact, how we talk to people, how we treat people. That's the good news. So this is a Sunday of humor, of laughter, and of finding out what we can do to trumpet out that good news. Stay tuned. I gotta get back up here. moving right along. Remember, a stingy planter gets a stingy crop. A lavish planter gets a lavish crop. I want each of you to take plenty of time to think it over and make up your own mind what you give. That will protect you against sob stories and arm twisting. God loves it when the giver delights in giving. From 2 Corinthians 9. Our morning offering will now be taken. Let us be in prayer. Lord, we come thanking you for the gift of joy, the gift that comes from knowing you and knowing that your purpose and will for us can never be taken away, can never be moved. The joy that comes from knowing that you are in charge and by that hook or crook, your will be done, that you are in charge of us. Indeed, Father, we rejoice with Jerusalem over your promises to them and to us. We thank you, Father, that in your wisdom you have appointed a time in our lives for laughter, and that laughter and a merry heart are means by which you bring healing. You bring wholeness to that which would otherwise be dried up and without beauty or vitality. Indeed, O Lord, we praise you by giving Abraham and Sarah laughter in their old age and forever, since sending us unto us those like Isaac who warm our hearts by their presence. Those people and events who enter our life when we think it is impossible and prove all our certainties to be entirely too limiting. Thank you, Lord, for granting to us a sense of the ridiculous and the ability to appreciate it when it comes to pass. Lord, bring hope, joy, and laughter and wholeness, rejoicing and healing today. We remember those that we carry in our hearts who are going through difficult times. We remember Pearl and Vi Virginia. We remember prayers for Linda Schroen, for Randy Tolman, who attended the Bread Ministry this past week. Are there others that we need to keep in prayer?
Yes. Sarah Collins and her family. She lost her husband a couple days ago.
Others?
Linda Anderson and Michael Schroeds both have stage 4 cancer.
Those cancer cases, yes.
Becky Jones and Denise Mintz.
We say congratulations to Dennis Guru.
We have prayers of praise for that 7 pound, as you wish at this point, 7 pound boy born this past week. Josiah Dennison.
Most of the congregation doesn't know this. Yesterday, I met with, I can't think of her first name, but her husband was Lawrence, Larry. They just bought a house down here. They moved down here, and he died. So she contacted Dennis. Dennis told her to contact me. And about 4 weeks, she's already had her husband cremated, but in about 4 weeks, they're going to rent the Dream Center, and they're going to have a memorial service for him. So, Billy Joe, would you please also remember Lawrence Urick, Y-U-R-E-K.
Urick. Obviously, it's a family that has found love in this area and wants to continue in this area.
She looked at me and she said, from what I've seen in the church, I like it. It won't be tomorrow, it might not be next week, but in a few weeks, you will see me coming here.
Again, we reach out in so many ways. Oh Lord, to the many people and situations we lift up to you at this time, to the joys, the sorrows, the times of uncertainty, and the times when we say, really, it happened? We did it? We give you great praise. And we ask you to bring us through those times as faithfully as you always do. Thank you, Lord. These things we ask in the name of Jesus, who taught us when we pray to say, Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Let us join now in a responsive reading of Scripture from Isaiah, the 61st chapter. I will sing for joy in God, explode in praise from deep in my soul.
He dressed me up in a suit of salvation. He outfitted me in a robe of righteousness, as a bridegroom who puts on a tuxedo, and a bride who is a
For as the earth bursts with spring wildflowers, and as a garden cascades with blossoms,
so the Master of God brings righteousness to both the womb and puts praise on display before the nations.
We get to the message fast today.
Yeah.
I tossed this one in a little fast. Yesterday is the past. Tomorrow, the future, and today is a gift. That's why we call it the present. You can learn a lot from Family Circus. We can also learn a lot, believe it or not, from Dennis the Menace. I meant to pull one and I didn't. Yesterday, there was one on Facebook, and it was, you know, the things you have joy with. And Mom's measuring him, and he says, "And if you count my cowlick, I'm 2 inches taller than that." Where do we see the joy? On your feet now, applaud God. Yes, Lord, I think you've been playing with my cat. On your feet now, applaud God. Bring a gift of laughter, sing yourself into his presence. That's right. It's Holy Laughter or Holy Humor Sunday. It's also called Bright Sunday. It is bright. The sun's shining, actually. If you've never heard of Holy Humor Sunday, you're in good company. That is, if you think that perhaps I hang around people in good company. Several years ago, I came across Good Humor or Holy Humor Sunday in one of the worship things I read frequently. My first response was, "So Hallmark's now going to tell us what we preach on?" It turns out that Holy Humor Sunday, also known as Laughter Sunday, God's Joke Sunday, the Easter Laugh, was cooked up in the 1400s by the church in Batavia. It was a day to remember the cosmic joke that God played on Satan. That's right. Satan said, "Hey, I've won! We killed him off! We don't have to worry about thy goodness, that love." But God had something else up his divine sleeve. Jesus was raised from the dead, death was defeated, and the joke was on Satan. And I'm sure God had a good laugh on that. On the Sunday after Easter, the Bavarian priest would continue to celebrate the joy of the resurrection in their sermon in an attempt to make the faithful laugh. After the service, people would gather to, and you're not going to do this, folks, would gather to play practical jokes on one another and tell funny stories. However, the funny stories would be nice to have if they were really funny. I guess my interest goes back to the thought of Holy Humor or Holy Laughter Sunday back in the 80s. Probably my third time at an Adrian Marsh workshop, music workshop, worship music workshop in
Binghamton.
Port Jervis. Richard Avery, songwriter, pastor of the Presbyterian Church, hosting the workshop, had welcomed a packed sanctuary, just like it is here today. All of us were eager to learn some new things about church music. Of course, we were also very excited to meet yet another songwriter, Hal Hobson. We had met,
Dick Avery. Dick Avery and Mark.
Well, that's who they are. I'm talking about the one who wrote Hymn of Promise. She was another one of the ones that was added at one of the workshops. And then we always bring all this music with them, things we probably never used, but we would go through them and we'd see where they could be used. We also learned some very wonderful things about how to enter new music. Donald Marsh got up to do his part, and he said, people say you can't use anything new in the church because people won't like it. He said, well, the first thing you do is you have your organist play for about 3 weeks, parts of it, during the prelude. And then you take that apart, and you do the chorus, and you have the choir sing that as a call to worship. And then, verse by verse, they use that as a call to worship. And then finally, they sing it. And then you have the kids come in and sing it. And the minute the kids sing it, it's sold. Because everybody's doing it. And the new music comes in. It didn't always work that way, trust me. Well, after the introductions and pointing out the exits, the restrooms, speaking into the schedule, when Donald Marsh came up, he said, he stood in front of us, he wore those Ben Franklin glasses. He looked at you just like this. And he had long, wavy, gray hair. He looked like he was right out of the 1700s. With a twinkle in his eye, he led us in a few hymns, and he said, okay, everybody on your feet. We're gonna sing Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee. Now, we knew we were in the presence of some serious worship music people, and we were going to sing that appropriately. Rich tones, perfect enunciation, seriously moving through the piece. Joyful, joyful, we adore thee. We got to about the second verse, maybe partway through, and Donald Marsh cut us off and said, sit down! Okay, what's this all about? Sternly he looked over those glasses again. Do you know what it looks like from up here? First, it looks as if you've all ingested the most sour thing in the world. There's no joy in your faces, only contorted looks. Then he went on to mention something along the line that we look like wooden statues. And that our body language did not speak of joy. We may have looked like wooden statues, but we were kind of like, the eyes were rolling. The bottom line was, if we are singing about joy, then we need to demonstrate joy. We need to be excited about it, be happy. The joy should just plain ooze out of us. But does it? In church, when we speak of God's love, God's forgiveness, I had an encounter that I'll never realize that I now realize is a kind of a message deliverer, listening to Charles Swindoll, author, preacher, theologian. He would preach a strong message. Listen to him every morning, unless I was in class. And he'd hit you with that Zynga line, you know, the one that says, and you know where you're all gonna be going. And after he had already given you joy and a lot of joy, and then he hit you with the zinger line of that. Then he delivered the punch. Hope! God doesn't leave you stranded. What's your problem? Do you believe the scripture? Do you believe in the scripture? Yeah? No? Yes? Maybe? Well, if you do, live it. Live the scripture. I've always tried to use that way when delivering God's word. Sometimes people get it and are filled with joy, and some choose to hold on to the zinger like all of sin to come short of the glory of God. I mean, not that we should forget that, but aren't we the Easter people? Do we believe in God's forgiveness? Do we believe that we're to love God? And we're to bring out the good in other people? Oh, there's no good in that. I was in the middle of a message while participating in a pulpit exchange. The pastor of the church I was preaching in entered the sanctuary. Somehow we had gotten through two services. There were some smiles, some giggles, and when it reached out like outright laughter on something I had said, his face turned to stone. I mean stone. He called me the next day. What? What was that all about? You do not smile or laugh in church. No one should be brought to laughter in church. They need to concentrate on their sinful nature. Okay, then. Well, since it's Holy Laughter Sunday, there needs to be a joke, right? There's plenty of jokes out there in the world, but some of them probably we shouldn't use here. Many of them are filled with degrading things. Age, gender, politics, both sides of the coin. Crude innuendos and words. Not at all holy laughter or humor. But I can do a man walked into a bar one. That's tacky for me. But I did find one that's very telling of our understanding of laughter and joy in church. Here goes. A man walks into church. He's a visitor. It's his first time coming through the doors of this particular church. Beautiful sunny day, just like this. He's in a good Sunday morning mood. He greets everyone he meets with enthusiasm, introduces himself, acts like he's known him forever. He sings the hymns at the top of his lungs, in spite of some funny looks he gets from those who are singing them in that dignified way, with good enunciation. During the greeting time, he hugs people, ignoring their offer of a polite but somewhat distant handshake. He laughs loudly, even shouts amen one or two times during the sermon. Have you ever heard anything so terrible? I'll remember to tell you about that one. After the service, a few people come to him and tell him, "That is not how we worship in this church." They suggest he might be more comfortable worshiping somewhere else. The man leaves the building, totally dejected. And when he gets outside, he sits down on the edge of the steps, trying to figure out what he did wrong. Next thing he knows, there's someone sitting next to him who puts his arm around him. And he says, "Don't feel bad. I've been trying to get into that church for years." Kind of brings to mind a scripture from Micah. But he's already made it plain how to live, what to do, what God is looking for in men and women. It's quite simple. Do what is fair and just to your neighbor. Be compassionate and loyal in your love. And don't take yourself too seriously. Take God seriously. Something I was going to tell you a little incident about. First time I ever preached was in my home church. I was just starting in the ministry route. Some of my students from the School of Nursing had come. There were two incidents that happened this day. The first was that I had a thing that when my students would act up in class, I wouldn't stop and point out to them they were, not paying attention. I would just do what I always called a pregnant pause. Last about 3 seconds. Well, there was a teacher sitting in the back of the congregation, and she decided it was a good time to have a conversation with her husband. But she wasn't even whispering. And so I just did the... Out of the corner of my eye, I look, and there's five of my students sitting there, and they're all like this. Which one of us is acting up? She stopped. We got into the sermon, and I don't even know what I say. I have no idea. I have never been in a church where anybody really did call out, yell out. Was so into what was being said, so filled with joy, with excitement, enthusiasm, that they called out. We had an African-American couple that was in our congregation. He was the choir director, actually, and Mary sat behind me in choir. And all of a sudden, whatever I said, she
had... Well, give a little description of where the choir sat.
Well, the choir sat up like over by where the piano is. And on this wall, there was a big window where the sun shined through. And She sat one day and she told us, what was his first name? Tom. Tom, would you please smile? None of us can see you. I'm like, she said, well, it's the truth. The only thing I see is a dark something dark up there. He even has to wear a dark suit and a dark shirt. I can't even see him. Well, she's sitting back there talking and everybody listening to this sermon, and all of a sudden, I hear, preach it, preach it, sister, preach it. Tell it to him like it is. Never have I heard it. It's a normal thing. Let's warm up to laughter Sunday. First of all, you can laugh at me trying to lead this as you join in. And you will join in. Everybody on your feet. That was a direct order.
A direct order? What are you going to do with it? Whip us?
I'm going to probably be down in here somewhere. Yeah. I've got to be able to see one of the screens.
I don't know. I look like Paul McCartney.
He's a kid.
Hmm? My lifetime, folks. There we go. No.
Nick T.
Well, I'll
sign
you
because
I have the link.
She lost something. I don't know. QuickBook. Okay, this is called Lift Your Name on High. The words will be on the screen. stop singing.
My forward wedding invitation, and what's nice is that Zazzle offers printing on different papers. This is a matte paper, and it's white. It's very nice, and it has...
You've done good. A little more enthusiasm, but you know, we started. We do it next week. It'll be all set. I'm going to paraphrase a scripture passage today about Jesus appearing to his disciples. It could easily start out like a man walks into a bar joke. Imagine a room in Jerusalem where a crowd of excited men and women are talking about what transpired in their community. They're telling about how Jesus appeared to Peter and others. Now, if you're trying to remember this whole story, where it appears in Scripture, don't bother. It's sort of a mashing together of several of the encounters with Jesus and Jesus' followers. Well, two men walk into that room. They had left Jerusalem earlier in the day, and they were on the road to Emmaus. Jesus walked and talked with them over the course of some miles, but they didn't recognize him. And they were wondering what his problem was. He didn't seem to understand why they looked so down in the mouth. What's going on? Are you the only one that doesn't know? Oh, we're just so devastated. We don't know what we're going to do now because our leader is gone. Gone! Well, Jesus continued to walk and talk with the two men over the course of some miles. Still not recognizing him, he stopped and they invited him to have something to eat. And then he broke the bread at the supper table. And the realization came. And then he vanished. The two men rushed back to the locked room in Jerusalem to tell the disciples and the others what they had just seen. The two men walk in the room and they hear people talking about how Jesus has been appearing to the members of the group. They say they've seen him too. They're pouring out what happened with Jesus on the road, what happened with Jesus at dinner after, and then Jesus walks in the room. That doesn't get you. He just shows up in the middle of all these people who've just been talking about seeing him. People who have seen him themselves, people who had eaten with him and walked with him and talked with him. How do they respond? Do they say, oh, Jesus, there you are, about time. We've been wondering when you would get here. Jesus sits down and talks with them. Are you hungry? We still have some dinner left over. Well, when Jesus appeared in their midst right after talking about how he had been appearing to members of the group, they do reach the obvious conclusion. This is really him. Now, they still think he's a ghost. They still think they're dreaming. They want him there so badly that it can't be him. Medical school students are warned not to look for a rare or obscure diagnosis when there's a more likely commonplace explanation for a given set of symptoms. They're told, when you hear hoofbeats, think horses, not zebras. But the disciples and others, no, they went right to the zebras. This could not be what it looks to be because it can't be. Jesus knew the kind of reaction that he would get. And probably in a sense, even though he talks to them all the way through, I've been teaching you these things for so long and you do not understand. But
he's pretty sure they're not going to get it right off. And he's kind of giggling to himself. When they really put it together, they'll blow their socks right off. I can imagine him just waiting for it. After all, how many other times have the disciples gotten things wrong? When he walked out to them on the water, thought he was a ghost. When he calmed the storm, what kind of person is this? Is he a sorcerer? He can do that? I don't understand. Mary, who's that guy in the garden? Oh, the gardener, right, gardener. Can't you hear him planning his appearance? Smiling in anticipation of another disciple response, clueless. And they didn't disappoint him. In spite of the fact that he told them he would be raised from the dead after 3 days, the angels told them he had risen, Peter, Mary, and 2 men from Emmaus said they had seen him, the other disciples still think it's far more reasonable to assume this is a ghost rather than Jesus, up close, personal, living, really living color. So he says, guys, what's the problem? Look, it's really me, skin, bones, you can touch me, and they're still disbelieving. Joyful, sure, but they still can't wrap their heads around this. And so while they're still hashing all this out, Jesus asks for something to eat. And when they give him fish, how about that got a chuckle out of Jesus? He just shared that with men on the road to Emmaus. Bread, ring any bells? Bread, fish, 5 loaves of bread, 2 fish. Yeah, I bet Jesus made the connection and laughed. But the disciples didn't still get the joke. They didn't see the Messiah, even though he was literally right before them. Not about the bread that opened their eyes, the men into Emmaus, that should ring some bells about the bread. Not about the connection between the bread and fish and the miracle, no, they didn't get that one either. And they certainly don't get the best joke connected with all of this. The divine joke God played on Satan. One way the church through the ages has explained Jesus' victory on the cross is by describing Jesus as a ransom for us all. And yes, it is. But Satan was holding humanity captive, thinking he really had God over a barrel. He demanded a ransom for all those sinful people in his church. And no mere mortal would do. Only God could pay the ransom. So the reasoning goes, God sent God's Son, who was crucified and died. And Satan said, ha, I win, and lets humanity go. But Satan does not have the last laugh. God still has a card to play, a trick up God's sleeve. God raises Jesus from the dead, and Satan has the rug pulled right out from under him. Ha, laughing out loud. Sorry, Satan. The joke's on you. God wins, and so do we. But do we act it? Do we act like we won? In the most glorious joke ever played, Satan still tries to have power over us, telling us we're wrong, reminding us how terrible we are, reminding us that we must be very somber for our church, because God will be very angry with us if we sing loud, if we respond, if we laugh. Oh, I grew up in a church where we didn't laugh. Trust me. One's a little that gets you every time. Jesus' entire life and ministry was full of humor, full of surprise, full of joy. Remember what he did at a wedding? What are you doing at a wedding?
He gave them the best wine.
He gave them the best wine that was there. The best wine.
And lots of it.
And lots of it. More than they had when they started with that poor stuff. He enjoyed people being happy. He enjoyed people lifting each other, being there for each other, doing things for each other. He loved that. Jesus said and did lots of things that would have been hilarious to his listeners and followers. We just miss a lot of it because of the barriers of time and culture and language that make it hard for us to understand it. Jesus was smart, clever, witty, and warm. We know that from his parables, his teachings. We know that people brought their children to him. And you know, children don't usually like grim, grumpy people. And he also told us we have to come like a child. A few days ago, I mentioned something about, I can't remember what the topic was, but I remember telling the story about the little boy that was acting up in church. And of course, the people are like, so the mother finally picked him up and gave a wham on the rear end and flipped him down on the seat. Probably broke the seat, you know, she threw him on it. And of course, the little one cried. She goes, there, that's how you should act in church. Crying. We know that Jesus wept. He had emotions. So surely he also laughed. Jokes and humor and laughter were a big part of Jesus' life and ministry. Just in the way he spoke and told parables. Some of those parables you really had to think about for a few minutes. Go around and around on them. Jokes, tricks, and humor of all kinds depend largely on one thing, the element of surprise. We're led to think of a story going one way and all of a sudden it zips and goes the other way. It ends entirely different. We laugh. The unexpected event, the unanticipated punchline, the surprise ending that grabs our attention and makes us howl. Maybe there's the problem. Maybe we've gotten so used to saying, well, of course Jesus rose from the dead. Yep, that's just the way it was. Really? We have to have that childlike belief, that childlike quality of seeing it through, of living it over again. It's funny, we don't live over those joyful things as much as we live over the sorrowful things. Think about it. We'll carry some of those sorrowful things to our graves, hurtful things, carry to our graves. But the good things, not always. Not always. But he does things like his parables, his interactions with people, his daily life, full of reversals. Unexpected taking place in place of the expected. The poor come out ahead of the rich. He reaches out to sinners rather than the outwardly righteous. Who's the one he screams at the most in Scripture? The religious.
Yeah, the leader.
Doesn't that give you a clue here? He ignores the rules while fully obeying God's commandments. Full of surprises, many of those downright funny when we think about them. And those surprises, along with his masterful use of humor, enable his followers to learn from and about him. I once heard a story on the radio that makes me wonder if it was the very surprise of Jesus' appearance among the disciples that helped them finally understand who he was and what had happened. It's a research thing, so it might be dry and boring, but I gotta tell you anyway. Researchers at Johns Hopkins University have found that babies' desire to learn increases when they are surprised by something. They want to explore it more. That's learning. They tried two different experiments. In one, it was a ramp with two walls at the end. Only the tops of the walls were visible. The bottoms of the walls were covered up so you couldn't actually see them. A ball was rolled down the ramp toward the walls. The baby seemed to understand the ball should be stopped by the wall, but then the cover was removed and the ball was resting against the second wall, as though it had rolled through the first one. In the second experiment, a toy truck was pushed across the table. Now they seemed to get the idea that when it got to the edge, it was going to whoosh. They had done that enough with their food, you know. So they knew where that was going. But the truck continued to roll along as if in thin air. The babies couldn't see it was attached to a slot in the wall behind it. After the test, researchers gave the babies the balls and trucks. Those who had not seen the toys behaved in surprising ways quickly lost interest in them. But the babies who were surprised spent a long time with each toy, banging the balls on the table to see if they would go through the surface, or pushing the truck to the edge to see if it would fall off or not. Babies who were surprised had greater desire to learn. Do we take the surprises in Scripture to learn more about them? We have to, that's why we talk to people about delving into the Scripture, Bible studies. Delve into it, see what it's about. What does it mean? What does it say to you? You know, sometimes when pastors give a sermon, somebody comes up to them and says something to them about, oh my goodness, you made it so clear for me. What did I say? And then they tell you what you made clear, and you look at them like they've got four heads. Were you listening to what I was talking about? But they were able to relate it to something in their life. I had an organist in one church that I preached at before I went into ministry, and several times I was at this one charge. And first time the organist and I chatted after the service, to the point I had to leave because I had to get to another church in another state. I had to move here, folks. And he comes out, gets up this morning from the organ, and he comes up to me, he's crying. He goes, I gotta get home. I'm sorry, I wanna stop and talk to you, but I just wanna tell you what you said. It made so much sense. I gotta go home and tell my wife she was right. Oh my goodness, I've really offended her. And I have no idea what I said. But it was open to his mind, something from Scripture, and the way I described it, that hit his own life. Perhaps that was that way with the disciples. Perhaps it was Jesus' surprising appearance among them that stimulated their desire and ability to learn and understand what he had done. We know from Scripture that this time they get it. When Jesus ascends to heaven, shortly afterwards they return to Jerusalem and the temple with great joy, worshiping God. And that continues on to the day of Pentecost. And that is there, through Peter's words, we know on that day Jesus walked into the room. They finally understood what Jesus had been trying to teach them. But, you know, maybe laughter seems a little too ordinary. A little too ordinary, a little too, crude. Maybe we want that sanctity, you know, the very holy. But what do we learn in Scripture on the subject? Psalm 34. Look to him that you may be radiant with joy. Joy-filled people have a glow. You can see it in their demeanor, in the way they talk to you. Or Christ's words to his disciples. I have said these things to you so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. So even when he says, I'm going to die, if they stop there, they weren't, this is going to make my joy complete. And I will rise in 3 days. Guess which part they missed? I will rise in 3 days. Gone. Do you glow with joy during worship? Do visitors see this glow in this congregation? Pope Francis dedicated many official letters to the churches about this, stating, there is no room in evangelization for sourpusses. That's the first time that it ever appeared in a papal letter. Let me clue you. There's no room for making disciples by sourpusses. His explanation went on. Proclaiming Christ means showing that to believe in and to follow him is not only something right and true, but something beautiful, capable of filling life with new splendor and profound joy, even in the midst of difficulties. Joy adapts and changes, but it always endures even as the flicker of light born of our personal certainty that when everything is said and done, we are infinitely loved. People can get the rest of that nonsense in he said, be not conformed to the world, but transform. By the renewing of your mind that you may prove what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. How are you going to prove if you're like, you will do it this way and that's the only way there is, you better do it. Like I said, stand now. That was an order. Although you did do it. I'll give you that. But you've got to do it in a way that people want to hear. I know we have to be, you know, firm. But you know, you can be real firm and pleasant. You can show joy. If they can see that this is something really within you, you really want, I want to share this with you. Please, can you just, I want to share this. Does your body, does your voice, do your words give that impression? Do you have a smile on our eye, a twinkle in our eye, I don't know, whatever, however it is you glow? Here's some things to think about. Some other words or things there. Blessed are you who hunger now, for you will be satisfied. Blessed are you who weep now, for you will laugh. We're so used to hearing you will be comforted. You will laugh. It started in the second year of seminary. Actually, it started at the end of the first year, only we didn't hear about it until the second year. When he came back, Alan came back, he admitted he almost didn't return. He and his wife decided on the way home they were going to take a little bit of an extended time and enjoy themselves before they went back home. They were the caregiver for their granddaughter when their daughter was working. She had somebody else watching them while they were down at seminary. The daughter had been in a very abusive situation and had gone out on her own. She was divorced. When they arrived home, there was a message to contact the police, which they did. Their daughter, the mother of the three-year-old granddaughter, had been murdered by her ex-husband. Of course, it was all over the TV, in the papers, and so on. They had total guardianship now of the granddaughter. And she would stand in front of the TV calling mommy every time her picture came on. And just before they came back down for the second year, they were taking him to court. He was going to be sentenced for the death of the daughter. And the little girl hadn't seen the pictures for a while. And they were trying to keep the TV on, but for whatever reason, she walked past one. I think they were out. It was like on a screen in a store. And she stood there and she started crying and laughing. Mommy, mommy's back, mommy's back, mommy's back. For the next 3 years, returning to seminary was a task. He was sad and grief until the last year. After lunch, on his way back to class, he passed by the art sculpture lab. And there he encountered Christ and true joy. He decided to go in and see what they were working on. He liked art. And he came face to face with a life-size sculpture. Jesus cradling the body of a dead person. Four years worth of tears flooded. He said he knew his daughter was in the arms of Christ. He was quick to return to his classmates and share the news. He was radiant with joy, and we were crying. Tears of joy for him. Not that his daughter died, but that because of Jesus, He knew she was alive in Christ. When have you encountered Christ? When has God awakened you to the good news? Did you receive it? Did it make a difference in your mind, your heart? Or did you kind of say, oh, I'm not sure, that's just... Actually, I know he's talking to Joyce, not me. I know he's talking to Bob, not me. God wouldn't want me doing that. Mm-hmm. No, that's not going to happen. I tried that with ministry. The car blew up. Jesus has a good sense of humor. How about you? Has Jesus walked into the room where you were and you didn't recognize him? Did you see him come up with every possible explanation, but not the right one? That the risen Christ is right in front of you and wants you to truly understand what it means that he was raised from the dead for you? Have you allowed Jesus to surprise you into wanting to know him better? To grasp that however well you think you know him, there is more to learn, more joy to experience. Have you truly gotten the joke that God played on Satan that day so long ago? That Satan thought Christ's death on the cross was the last word, but God spoke the last true punchline in raising Jesus from the dead, erasing the fear of death for each of us. A couple ramblings I've shared over the years on joy and happiness and the humor and laughter that comes from our relationship. Our mouths are filled with laughter, our tongues and songs of joy. When it was said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. I was talking about an amazing few days we had experiencing family gathered, remembering, looking back, looking forward, sharing, learning. Five of us shared a new experience of the Christmas show at the Alabama Theater. It was amazing. And then a family went back, oldest daughter finally catching up on some things she needed to do, the ones going back to Baltimore. Yet through those days, as I listened and watched and experienced how, and now reflect, I think of how God placed joy in our hearts and given us the ability to laugh. How often we shy away from it as if laughter were an evil thing. Throughout the scripture, there are references to joy, to praising, and yes, to laughter. We celebrate with praises, joys, laughter when we've come through a hard time and when we in the throes of sorrow, of hardships, as we have hope. The memory of the times how God has safely brought us through them before, and even in the face of difficulties, we can be joyful. As I said, our mouths are filled with laughter, our tongues with songs of joy. And it was said among the nations, the Lord has done great things for them. Do people say that God's done great things? The Lord has taken our sins, has given us hope, has given us new life? Do people see that? In our daily lives, there will be those things that seem to want us to dwell on the negative, who want us to believe that no one can be trusted, that we need to build a barrier around ourselves or will not, so we can't be polluted by the outside. You know, as one place I served said, those kind of people. But it's on the outside that we share and show God's love. It's not within our own group. It is then others will see the Lord has done great things for them. When we can laugh, live in joy, live in hope. Here's another one to think about. May your walls know joy, may every room hold laughter, and may every window be open to great possibility. Go out in joy, don't be afraid to laugh, and praise God with your words and actions. God will let you laugh. You'll raise the roof with shouts of joy. When I think of those words, I think of events going on in the world, in this country, in our city, places of employment, schools, homes, and even our places of worship. There seems to be little humor or joy or laughter these days. And then there is that line I read, a day without laughter is a day wasted. Remember the old ad, a day without orange juice, but it's like a day without what? Sunshine. That was Anita Bryant's one she had for her for the Orange Juice ads. Laughter reflects joy in our hearts. Reflects a thanksgiving for things that make us see things in a different way. We don't see everything in that blech. But sometimes we're afraid to let people know we see good in somebody. Why? Because they've told us they're no good. And if you, remember the thing when we were growing up? If you like her, you can't like me. We can't be friends. Let me tell you, it makes it into adulthood. Everything isn't bleak. Everything isn't dark. Oh, look, there's got to be the glory. I finally found them. It wasn't at the end, it wasn't at the beginning. Banish the darkness in your heart, fill it instead with joy. Proverbs 17, a happy heart is good medicine. A cheerful mind works healing, but a broken spirit dries up the bones. When the heart and mind are filled with the joy of the Lord, our life is repaired. I don't think we all want to go around with broken bodies and hearts and minds. Our life has changed, it's magnified, but without it, we shrivel up and die. The poet Ralph Waldo Emerson sums up our life this way: to laugh often and much, to win the respect of intelligent people and affection of children, to earn the appreciation of honest critics and endure the betrayal of false friends, to appreciate beauty, to find the best in others, to leave the world a bit better, whether by a healthy child, a garden patch, or a redeemed social condition. To know even one life is breathed easier because you have lived. This is to have succeeded. Give God thanks for the gift of laughter and for those who share laughter with you. When our girls were small, I used to tell them, maybe one of those moves, I'd say, don't you dare smile. Don't smile. Do not smile. And I'd keep it up for a couple minutes. Within a matter of minutes, the offending victim would go out of grumpiness, dissolving into laughter, and we would be laughing right along with them. Sometimes we don't think there's any reason to smile. Things aren't going well. We don't consider anything except what is before us. The problem is we take that into the world. People around us are as miserable as we are. And sometimes I think we'd like that. I had worked with somebody. I don't know why you're so happy. Let me tell you what's going on. Okay. Can I tell you what's going on in my life? No, it can't be near as bad as what I'm going on. Well, I won't tell you then. Because I'm choosing to be happy. I'm choosing to move forward. I'm choosing to know that God is in control. We point to things that are terrible. Somebody tries to make it better, we say fine. Then we go find something else that's terrible. I actually had somebody that worked with that had always had in reserve another problem. If she came in and wanted some help with something, I'd get her through that. She said, okay, now, but now I have to think about this. Why? Can you be happy with this one we solved? For 3 minutes, that's all I'm asking. Till you get out of here and I close the door and lock it. Song from Christmas. Third stanza. I heard the bells on Christmas Day. And in despair I bowed my head. There is no peace on earth, I said. For hate is strong and mocks the song of peace on earth, goodwill to men. If there's no peace on earth, if hate is so strong that the words peace on earth, goodwill to men are false, who's to blame? Him, her, them? No. It starts with us. It starts in our hearts. And if we're really in that and not looking for the good, we're playing into it. The song goes on to say, then peal the bells more loud and deep. God is not dead, nor doth he sleep. The wrong shall fail, the right prevail. With peace on earth, goodwill to men. A joyful, cheer heart brings healing. both body and soul. But the one whose heart is crushed struggles with sickness and depression. Stop crushing hearts. Instead, bring the warmth of God's love, a smile, hope. This is my prayer, that my soul smile through my heart and my heart smile through my eyes, that I may scatter rich smiles and sad hearts. This is what Holy Humor Sunday celebrates. We celebrate knowing what we have been freed from the power of sin and death. We laugh at the defeat of Satan's imagined power and laugh with joy over Christ's victory on the cross. And in the resurrection, we laugh out in gratitude. And I'm really going late. Good thing I left some things out. And we laugh at the light that we are on the Easter, that we are in on the Easter joke that assured us of eternal life. Do you mind if I change the last hymn?
To what?
Joyful, joyful, we adore thee. She's like, oh, she's only like, smile.
Really?
It's 89. I don't have it on the side. I put it here if there was time. Actually, there isn't another hymn, so we'll just do it. And I don't have to see if I can find the other one. Okay, we're going to try this again. As Donald Marsh said, let's not be eating that sourest thing you've ever had. Don't be a wooden soldier. Let joy ooze from you. Be filled with joy. On your feet, applaud God. Bring a gift of laughter. Sing yourself into his presence. Take it with you and share it wherever you go. Amen. Amen.